Come on, y'all can give God another praise. Come on, let's not pity cat it this morning. Come on. Hallelujah. In the face of adversity, shaka the bone now. What will you do? Amen. Come on now. Sometimes I get an attitude. Don't know about y'all, but God said, hey, I don't like that. Come on now. Because we lack understanding and we lack clarity. But you know what I've learned? The president stole my stuff. I'm just speaking into this. She said, when we fight, we win. Michelle Obama got up and said something. Come on, Lord, you give one more praise for the band and the praise team this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I learned this, that when the enemy is fighting and God has allowed it, you know, I preached the last part of Uncharted Waters last week. Amen. The finale. We're all experiencing in this season uncharted waters. But what are you going to do? It's unfamiliar. You don't like it. It disgusts you. It makes you mad. Come on now, but what will you do? Will you run back and hide and tuck it, or will you take it and elevate from it? Amen? Because all of us are going to be tried in something. Because I learned when God loose us too much, we get loosey-goosey. Come on now, we get loosey-goosey, and we get to doing things because we feel like God has empowered us and gave us a little bit of something so we don't maintain and so we can't be sustained. We don't maintain to be consistent. That's what makes us get messed up and in trouble. We're not consistent. We're here, we're there, we're everywhere. Amen? Consistency is the key to a blessing after obedience. So she said something. Hallelujah. She said, you remember last time we said when they go low, we go high. She said, but not this time. When you go low, I'm coming down there with you and for you. And you know, usually God don't let the lion, come on now, stand out and get up. But I can tell you in this season, the lion is roaring. Amen? Come on, give God a praise. It don't mean we ain't shamed and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost. But if you go low, I'm coming down there to get you. Shaka no more shaka. And I'm standing 10 toes down. You know why? Because being nice to people gives them an opportunity to run back over you. So God said, take it off the table and just keep time. Let people be offended in this season sometimes. Let them don't like you because they don't like you anyway. God told me to love you. He didn't say I have to like you. So I went over to get some meat from the meat counter. Over at one of the Smiths, and here this lady come on me. I saw the devil all over her. I said, I'm about to jump on this counter. I'm going to keep the Carol down. You don't want to be Carol, amen? She ain't holy. She ain't righteous. And she may give you a knuckle sandwich, amen? But Pastor Carol is going to be submitted to the power of God when it comes to temperance. But God said, roar like a lion. Get up on all fours. And I'm going to explain that to you too. Go ahead and have your seat. So she came looking all mean. I saw that demon on her. Hallelujah. So I looked at her and I said, what? I said, you mad? She said, oh, no, I'm just focused. I said, no, you're not. You got an attitude. And I didn't have no smile on my face. I looked at that devil square in the eye. I said, what you want to do? Devil will only tangle with you when you are powerless. When you are full of the anointing of God and have power, it calls the devil to be powerless. I said, don't mess up my day, devil. I threw it back on her, pow. And then she tried to smile. I looked at her in my face like, hurry up with my meat. I didn't even say thank you. Put it in my basket, looked at her and rolled off. I'm not looking away. I'm not looking down. I'm not looking with my eyes closed. Keep your eyes open on the enemy in this season. The Bible says pray that you enter not into temptation in this season. And when I got back to the store, I said, where's Dee at? And God looked, I said, she got a stinking nasty attitude. But because I prayed, God told me not to call the general manager and tell on her. In this season, if they go low, I'm coming down there. Huh? Zion, no pastor was like that. She just, now you know. Cut it out. Amen? As long as we kind and name the name of Jesus, then put nice on it, people will be abrupt, people will be disrespectful, people will do what they think they can get away with. My mom can tell you I've never been afraid of people of no status and caliber. But I choose to be respectful. Amen? So throw mice off the table this season. Don't get done again. Just keep kind on there. In this season, we got to fight the enemy every step of the way. We cannot be callous and slowful and powerless. We cannot pity pat it up at any time, because it will slip in and overtake you, and before you know it, your mind is messed up. And if your mind is messed up, how you perceive things, how you walk a thing, how you live a thing, all of that's going to be messed up and tore up. And there are people on the outside laughing at you and not with you, because they see that you're acting a fool. He won't tell the trouble. They won't tell the truth, because they want you. They want to be a little bit better than you. She'll let you walk all day with a booger in your nose. I said, oh, girl, did you see me? He got a booger. And carry on and don't speak the truth. Amen? People that love you are going to speak the truth. Huh? Give God a praise for hashtag my man. Come on. Come on. Come on. He had her slip and fall. He broke his ankle, but guess what? He got a message for y'all on tomorrow, on Mondays, from the pastor's desk. Come on, give God a praise. Come on, come on. He said, I got something too. He said, I got something. I said, good. Because we must always keep the man's voice, even though I am the pastor with equal authority. We must also keep out his voice in here, King Ahasuerus. Amen? Voices are powerful. The devil know you by your voice if you jerking around or you for real and sincere. He will answer the call in Jesus' name. Amen? Hey, baby, how you doing? You doing all right? She said, Pastor, I'm on my way. Ain't nothing like love, is it? Nothing like love. I didn't know you was, you know, in relationship with these two here, because you be on my Facebook talking, Pastor. Yeah, you know, I've been wooing and cooing. Come on here. Come on, what you doing? And sometimes God lets a situation happen to draw you nigh. Amen? He'll do that. And I'm still the same person. Amen? Come on, how you doing, husband? Y'all doing all right? They said, we on our way. Be on your way in the house of God. It's good for your soul. Didn't that make you feel good when you came up here and God had all this love up here? Come on, because my greatest gift is love. Come on. And loving on you. Come on. And you said, I like that. There's nothing like the power of love. Amen? It will bring healing, restoration. Come on now. It will bring blessings, manifestation will happen because of love. And that's what gets people off track with me, huh? They say, she's so loving. And then when I draw them forth, pow, they say, she just hit me in my face. I'm a lion. The thing is, with a lion, he doesn't get up for insignificant things. Come on now. I said this at the very first mentor-mentee leadership conference in the Kente, about 39 mentees there. And I said, they said, huh, what she mean by that? So I unpacked it. A lion sits with the paws crossed. You don't see him rather just get up and get the bucket and can on. That's immaturity. Not for a lion. He can't play around like that, huh? So I said, I see and I sit. Why am I going to get up for a buzzard, some flies, a wild dog, come on, a wild rabbit, and get them going crazy? It's insignificant. Yes, it's an irritant. It's frustrating. It's like, get out of my face. What are you doing? But if it is significant, then I'm going to get on all fours and roar. I'm a lion. Come on, give God a praise. Hey, Wendy. Come on, give God a praise. Sometimes you have to be a lion. The devil knows when you are a lion. Trust and believe me, he knows it. Amen? And people know it too. Something about you. I say, is it? Sometimes I let people say that to me. It's something about you. Amen? So if they go low this season, we're going low. We're going to take care of business. Come on, we still going to be in the spirit. And then we go, you know, we go lift on up. Amen? Because I don't want, we ain't going to go that way. And this should force me, really force me. Because I told God, cast devils out two ways. Because I was at a conference one time, and the devil was really bucking in this one lady. She had a demon in her. Come on, how many know we cast out devils over here? Come on. We cast out devils over here. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. So I saw her. I told my team. I said, listen, this is a demon here. She's going to try to disrupt service. I said, get the deacons. Even though it was a prophetic conference, I said, get the deacons. Send them to come get her when she was acting up. She was acting up, and the deacons was coming to get her, but the leaders didn't see how to really deal with her. Now, you got all these people up in this place. They said, who is this lady from Las Vegas, this prophetess? I wasn't the pastor at the time. And her name was rare to see who I was. Come on now. I had a bob cut, asymmetric bow, two-tone, coming around the face. I mean, it was stacked in the back. You got to stack that. When you're wearing that bob, you stack it up. So they was intrigued. Because people look with their eyes. And representation is everything. So they say, we want to see who this lady is from Vegas. So the devil got the bucking and carrying on. And you know, she bucked so much, she bucked the whole service, messed up the service, the pastors wasn't in the spirit, trying to cast the devil out. Never cast the devil out of somebody that wants it. Remember I said, let them go with that devil and let it torment the hell out of them, and they will find them a Carol Simpson somewhere to get it cast out. Amen? Because I'm not going to mess up my clothes, mess the tips of my shoes up, sweat out my armpits, or mess up my hairdo. If you want to keep a devil, keep it. Because after a while, it's going to torment the hell out of you up in your house alone. I know what I'm talking about. And you're going to find somebody to help you. You hear what I'm saying? So she bucked and messed up the service that day. But the next day, she came back. I said, are you ready to behave? She said, yes, ma'am. She said, I don't want nobody praying for me, but Prophet Skill. Devil knows. She said, Mama, get rid of this devil. I don't want her to touch me. And her pastor, she was there. The man was there, but the woman was. And she said in her spirit, this before she got delivered a little bit the next day, she said, I'm going to hit her in the face. Devil's talking in the spirit realm, and I don't use that gift so often, but yes, I will see what's in your mind when you're talking. Amen? So she was talking in her mind, I'm going to hit her in the face. And I said, man, this is me just hearing something. Huh? She balled up. I looked down at her fist. She had a fist balled up. I said, if you hit me, devil, I'm going to knock you the hell out in this conference. And I'm going to still preach, prophesy, receive an offering, and get on up out of here. Come on, give God a praise for that. Know what I said? That the devil loosed her hands like that. Like, that's what I thought, devil. You ain't stupid and you ain't crazy. Devils be talking. Just like we talking. The Bible says Jesus, he is a spirit. And those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The devil is a spirit too. He has to get in a body and a being in order to operate. That's how I saw that devil and demon and that lady at the meat counter. I saw when she turned around, she manifested, but she had no power. Only to irritate me. Huh? And God so often will take me every once in a while in the spirit of darkness to show me people in the church and in the world or will be around me who's messing with demonic powers. He said, see that? See who they are? See what they do? Pa, 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 pa. And close it up. He said, now you know. I don't go in there, so I'm going to go in darkness. I'm going to go in light. No, it's for me to be informed of what's in the midst of me. Huh? Demons are walking every day on the earth manifesting and doing things and saints so caught up and so busy in foolishness, they don't even detect or discern that it's a demon amongst them. That's how they overtake and conquer. Because we are not aware of our surroundings and who they are. Because they smile. Why does the Bible say, talk about the sheep and the wolf? And wolf in sheep's clothing, because sheep, one time or another, they were a sheep being obedient and then lost their way and got disobedient and became a wolf. That's why they can smell and look like sheep, because they are aware and be able to mimic who the sheep is, because they've been in the midst, they've been around. But God, let me tell you something, when the anointing is on you, he'll snatch the covers off of them and show you clearly who they really are. Remember, Jesus only only confronted Judas one time before he was killed by his own hand. You have to confront devils for one time. Then they'll know who you are, and they'll say, I'm not going to try that. That's why I tell you to stay in the corral, sheep. Because if the wolf gets your leg because you acting loosey-goosey, then sometimes you're going to get taken. I'm saying, yeah, I saw the wolf. The wolf was taking him up the hill. Because sometimes we need to learn a lesson that we are not tougher than God. Amen? Or his spirit. When he say no, when he say stop, when he say nah, don't go that way, that is what he means, because there is a trap set of the enemy to ensnare you and trap you and mess up your whole life. I don't care how the devil looks. People are like, she got to do all. I'm doing all of that. And then some. To keep the enemy out of my life, out of my mind, out of my spirit, out of my home, out of my marriage, out of my money, out of this ministry, whatever it takes, I'm going to obey God. Is that all right? Come on, give God some praise. And look at your name. We talk about purpose today, but it's working for your good. Come on, say it with me. It's working for your good. Hallelujah. Praise God for my mama, my daddy. My mama, 81. Got her right mind with a sword out of power. Come on, don't think she don't see. She'll grab your hand and say, you'll say, huh, what you say? Who was that? She'll throw a prophetic word on you and come on now, wrangle you in. You don't even know it. Baby, the Lord was telling me, he like, huh? Have a y'all experienced it. Come on. You got your word, didn't you? Said, yeah. Son, how you doing? Oh, she's gonna pop something off. She'll come on, she do it. She will do it. Amen. Hallelujah. I thank God for her. Amen. Hallelujah. Last week, God told me when I did the finale, he said, you ask the people for $12. I said, well, God, you know, we fell out for 2 Sundays. Maybe they don't apply, you know, this time. Remember, I was telling the whales about it. They said, we're gonna send it in. Because sometimes when God do things, we want to be a part of it. I said, God said, tell me to give $12. Now, come on, not $120, $12. He said, because we're ending a cycle. See, if you've been around in certain cycles, you don't want to repeat them again. You don't want to be a repeat offender. Amen? So he said, we're going in that $12 to end, we'll end in one cycle, and we're starting a new cycle. In our lives, in our homes, in our marriages, in our, come on, our health, we're starting a new cycle. And God said, it's a great cycle. Amen? And in this ministry, $12. So if you want to get on that, just prepare that and have it ready. Come on now. Where you gonna go? I've been places they said, come on, these ministries. You go, can you get $1,200? All that kind of stuff. $12. You can't beat that. You make sure you sow a seed for her for $12 for a new cycle, a new great cycle for her that's coming. Amen. I gave my way out when I was on that bed with that stroke, baby. I said, God said, the devil can't kill purpose. Amen. You a giver and a tither. He cannot kill purpose. Did you hear what I'm saying to you? And I gave my way amen out right there. I sure did. I have been giving, and I gave my way out. If you learn how to give your way out of stuff and then prepare for the future, see, what we do is prepare for the now. And then when the future comes, it catch us up, and God says, I told you to do this. I told you to do that. You disobeyed here. You disobeyed there. And come on. And he is merciful, but he will allow you to suffer some things when he tells you to be obedient. Stay consistent. In this season, I gave my way out of certain cycles. Yes, I did. People, I wanted to hit them right in the fast. Not the face, the fast. I said, I'm going to get this money because this is going to keep me in my hands to myself. Don't keep my mouth quiet. Keep my heart right, because I want to hate them. Because people do just that type of devastating things and mean and nasty things to you sometimes. Amen? So you got to keep your heart guarded. Amen? So nothing gets in there. Unforgiveness. Come on now. Resentment. Bitterness. Oh, I'm talking this morning already. Amen? So if you want to be a part of that, have your $12 ready. So after I get done unpacking this word today, you can put it in a bucket and say, my cycle has changed. Amen? Let's say together, my cycle has changed. God said, go get that $12. I went to my account, not pastor's account. Because, yeah, I'm on that one too. But that got to pay the bills. Because Wednesday, I tear this church up. It's payday. I don't miss one. Huh? Hallelujah. So I gave my own $12. Amen? I said, I got to give it because I have to have this new cycle. Romans 8 and 28. Look, I'm over there in that Romans prophet Otis. You didn't even know. I said, if he go walk up. This was in my spirit weeks ago. He said, when you come up next time after the uncharted waters, he said, I want you to preach on Romans 8 and 28. It's working for the good. Because in it is purpose. Amen? Romans 8 and 28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Father God, I ask you to bless this word. Blow your ruha breath, the anointing on this word, to minister to the hearts and minds and souls of your people. God, don't let us leave this place the same, but let us leave changed, challenged, and convicted. And we give you praise for what you're getting ready to do. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your power to resurrect, your power to heal, your power to deliver, your power to set free. Thank you for your power to change our minds and elevate our minds and our spirits. Thank you for your love. And we give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Purpose, the reason for which something is done or created or for which something exists. All of you have a purpose that's sitting in this place. That's why you are existing. Now, if you know what it is, it all depends. Because you need to talk to God sincerely. That's why we got to get all the junk out of our spirit. It's so muddled with stuff that's insignificant. You can't even see your full purpose. And if you don't do that before you know it, you'll wake up and you're 69. And you have not even walked in the real purpose of God that he has in your life. Amen? So I went off into, God says to me, he says, go off into Genesis talking about Joseph. I love that story. Genesis 37 and started at the fifth verse. Joseph had dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And if you ever know, I just noticed this prophet, when I was reading this, he said, yet the more. So they was already hating him. It jumped out on me. Yet the more. Sometimes people can be around you, they really don't like you like that. Come on now. They're just around for whatever reason. But he said, and they hated him yet the more. You hear that, Reverend Bobby? Yet the more. You think they're liking you. You think you got something to offer. That's why they're around. But they hated you yet the more. So there's already some haterade going on. That's what my mama called. Said, baby, they ain't doing them a bunch of haterade. She didn't say Gatorade, haterade. You know, I love older folks. They just be putting it down like it is. Yeah, you got to give the spirit of whatever to interpret it. Okay? Say, baby, ain't nothing but a bunch of haterade. I mean, they hating on you real big. Amen? For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheep arose and also stood upright, and behold, your sheaves stood round about and made obeisance to my sheep. Sheep. So he began to tell his brethren that he was going to have reign over them and have dominion over them. And they hated him yet the more for his dreams. You're just going to keep on talking, Joseph. We already hate you, and now you've had this dream, and God said, you are chosen, and we got to serve you. You're going to reign over us? Come on. Because right now, it only looks like you just got the color, the coat of many colors. You ain't got nothing but a Toyota. What you talking? I'm going to have me a Bentley and a Mercedes. I'm going to have a big house and just diamonds and gear. And I'm going to have a ministry. I'm going to have a good job. I'm going to have a business. You know, well, you got to be careful when you declare and decree in the open to people of what you're going to have. I learned to move in silence and then boom, execute. That's why they said, what they doing now from the pastor's desk? Because you're not going to be privy to a lot of stuff I put my knees to the ground and talk to the Father and then begin to orchestrate and underneath come and put things in place. And then all of a sudden, bam, they see a fire all real. What they doing now? Come on, they move in silence and then execute. The old folks say, don't let your left hand know what your right hand doing. I'm a talker, not a gossip, but we shouldn't talk so much. People are not for you. People want to kill your dreams. People want to smash down what God has put in you, the purpose. Guess what? If you talk too much to the wrong people trying to show out, they will pray in the spirit realm and darkness and bring you to a demise. I know what I'm talking about. They will pray on you, P-R-E-Y, and then pray against you, P-R-A-Y. They hated him the more because he kept on talking and revealing what he really was called to. So, and it came to pass when Joseph was coming to his brethren that they stripped Joseph out of his coat. They said, when daddy gone, we're going to get you. Of many colors that was on him. Don't you know people will strip off the very value? That's what that means. The very value that God has given you before the blessing of who you are is manifested. They will strip it away and steal it because you told them a little bit too much. But it's working together for your good. And they took him and cast him into the pit. See, daddy not around. We're going to see what you working with. You think you all in that advantage and you mean what your keep said. Yeah, well, I'll put you in the back. See how y'all lock it over there. And we're going to strip you of your value. Because you ain't yet seen the manifestation of the promise that's on you. So we're going to strip you before you see it. And throw you in confusion. And going to take you the longer and delay to get back to so your vision can be cleared up like Samson to see who God said you really are. And what he's really going to do for you is working for your good. And there was no water. Anytime you're in a pit, and it's dark and no water, there's no life. But it says, but God was with him. Huh? He said God was with him. That's what God kept saying, he was with him. So even though you're in a dark place, that's going to be a part of your process to the throne, to your blessings. It says in Genesis 39:4, it says that Joseph found grace in his sight and he served him. He made him his overseer over his house and all that he had and he put it into his hand. So Joseph comes out the pit at that mark right there. Come on, the Midianites. When I studied the Midianites, they were not of his culture. But God will use whatever he want to use to get you out of a pit for a season. He will use a Jehovah's Witness, Buddhist. But we always want to get the word from somebody that we love that love us. Sometimes God want to send it through your enemy so they can go on, speak the word in power, go there. Because he wants you to owe no man nothing but love. Amen? Don't get caught up into people. What we say over here, we are guides and not gods. Amen? Keep your eyes on Jesus. We just going to guide you over here, over there. Come on. So he had an opportunity to come out the pit. But what we do when we come out the pit, he went into Potiphar's house, and God, he gave the run of the house. What we do, we get happy. I said that at the beginning. We get happy. We start getting loosey-goosey. Can't find us. Girl, I ain't going to church today because, you know, I'm feeling good. After y'all had prayed all over, they feel all out and all the kind of stuff. Now you ain't missing an action. You know why? Because they feel a little empowered. Come on now. They feel they got a little strength now. I can do something on my own. I ain't going up over there. So they get loosey-goosey. They don't be consistent. They get loosey, get lax. And then until another devil come, and they get thrown in a prison. At this point, I look at them and say, they all right. They didn't fall out over there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they all right. Because they don't deserve all that virtue. We run to people's rescue too soon and too often. Come on. You must guard the anointing that's upon you. Well, I don't care if it's a tidbit. Well, you must guard it. Don't be trying to show out and throw all your virtue on people and all the anointing. Because they need to be proven for a season. Amen? I know I've been hearing people mind say, me, come on, Pastor Carol, come on, pick me out. And I said, no. Because you're going to be consistent and show God something, and then he will release me. Amen? Because people be jerking around. Amen? So instead of saying, well, you know, wait a minute, God, let me say, I told God, when I get blessed, I said this coming back into the Lord at 21, 22. When I get blessed, I want to maintain what you give me, God. I don't want to get loosey-goosey, lose it and fall back, and then I got to build that up, and then go, I don't feel like that's a bunch of drama to me. Why don't we just maintain what God has given us until the next cycle, until the next purpose, until the next process? No, we lose everything being disobedient and have to repeat cycles over again. I don't want to be a repeat offender. I'm going to preach that too. A lot of us are repeat offenders. We keep doing the same thing and expecting different results. No, stop being a repeat offender. Just leave some stuff alone forever. So he was in that house and he got comfortable. Anytime you're too comfortable, like uncharted waters, God got to strike you. Because you ain't going to act right. Flesh is enmity. Enmity against God. It can never please him. It's going to compromise, slip and slide, and do stuff. We do that. But thank God for his grace. He hits you right on the leg. Pow, get back in line and get back in order. So she told on him and lied on him, and he had to run out. Amen? And Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound. And he was there in the prison. Don't you know God will take you and put you amongst people that are bound up? You bound up too, but you got to live in sight. You ain't all, you know, they hoard around, but you ain't already all the way home. And just tipping and tipping, put your, you know, tipping and nipping and sipping and nipping. But you say, I ain't going to go with Gary, though. I ain't going to go with Gary. I ain't gonna go with Lucy. I know I went with Paul and Jack. I'm not going with Bernard. So you be selective. So you can see a little bit. Your eyes are a little cringed open. You ain't gonna go with Sally and Sue. You already went with Becky. You got some kind of boundary. And I did that. I said, baby, I don't shackle. And I was the biggest fornicator ever. Come on, get into it. I had some standards. I was bound still. Come on. I'm talking the truth of where I was, what I did. And where y'all are, what you're doing. Get that? That's why I don't call people out and say, you in sin and you doing this. And that. I know, but guess what? Because the spirit realm is not private. This one prophet says, I choose not to say it because it is of no importance, because we all going through something. Come on, give God a praise. Come on, all of y'all. Come on. I see you, but I don't mention certain things because it is of no importance. Huh? If I mention something, then it's important to God. And he wants to bless you or warn you so you don't get unblessed. Amen? It don't mean that I don't see. Amen? It's just that it's of no importance of what I'm seeing. Amen? So, he's in the prison now. They bound him, and he is too. But he got a little crack in his eye. He can see some stuff. And the Bible says, and God was with him. God will be with you in your mess, in your pit, in your prison, in your disobedience, rebellion, because he's always trying to get you into a place of freedom. Because he's merciful and loving. And let me tell you something, to get you in that place, he will afflict you. Come on, he will. He'll let the bottom drop out of your life to get your attention when he is in need of you. Won't he do it, woman of God? When he wants you, for this nation, for this world, you got a message. He will at the bottom fall out. You say, God, when I serve you, I love you. Me and I talk about this. We tithe, we pray, we yell, we speak in tongues. But guess what? God wants total obedience. That there pleases God more than anything that you can do. He said, bodily exercise, probably nothing. You're shouting, all this stuff. But if you wrap it up in obedience, it will profit you much. So he in the prison and he in bondage with them. And then all of a sudden, because you got a little anointing on you, come on. And you really do love God. Come on. The king sends for you. than favor. Come on, don't you know the enemy want to strip you of your favor? He want to strip you of your favor. Did you hear what I'm saying to you? He want to backtrack you. He want to eliminate your favor. And we hand it over sometimes not paying attention. Getting caught up with friends and loved ones and all that stuff. My family say they call me Cal. Cal don't say it. Cal don't say it. I said, what y'all doing? Y'all gonna get in trouble. We're gonna tell you, I'm gone. Because I was in trouble too, that stupid that. I'm out. I said again, like my daughter said, Teresa, I want, you kept this all, I'm telling, because I'm in the first deal. Me too, I'm in the first deal. You sit there, keep on, I don't know who had the knife. I don't know if it was Jesse, I don't know if it was Junebug. Junebug had the knife and Jesse had the gun. They hit the girl on the cheek and the foot, and then they hit her with the car door. I run it all down, piece by piece, blow by blow. You get me, tough? Not playing. I'm getting the first deal with God and man. You know she's a swiller. She's a talented. She sure is. Devil is a liar. Trying to hold on. I'm going to hold on for my friend. You going to jail. I may be going too, but you're going the first deal. I thought that was smart. You know, oh, I'm going to take that. Johnny, what happened was we both went and we were smoking and then we... I'm telling. But I said, God forgive me and I got out of there. They're over there still with them. I'm going to go and get smacked down, pow, and I'm out of there. You hear me? Hallelujah. So they called for him. Pharaoh sent and called Joseph. This is Genesis 41. And they brought him hastily out of the dungeon. And he shaved himself and changed his raiment and came in unto Pharaoh. Don't you know when God called for you and you've been in that pit and had that process and then you went into Potiphar's house, come on, and you was over that, amen, you was pretty decent and good at that, come on now, and then you got lied on because you got comfortable. That's the only thing you did. You just got comfortable. Come on now. And God had to smack you a little bit. And then you went to the prison. Guess what? When you get there, you remember all the process that God brought you through. God, you healed me here. You delivered me there. You blessed me here. Lord, you chastised me there. You was merciful on my job. I didn't get caught, God. When they said they're going to fire me and I need to pay my bills, you sent them away. The boss got fired and I was still there because you was merciful. He remembers all of that. And then he began to praise God in spite of it. And guess what? They could see the anointing and the power on Joseph. And guess what? The king knew God will send somebody, come on down, to lift you out of your prison, out of your ravens, and he will change your name, change what you got on, and he will see that you are designed for purpose and got favor on you. He called for you. Your time is coming. Shakakobasa. And even though one guy that he ministered to, he got out of there, the banker, and forgot all about. That's what people will do. You will speak a word in their life. You'll be a blessing to them. And they'll get out with their friends and get amongst their colleagues. And they forget what God used you to do. How God used you to raise them out the pit and change their lives around. They forget about it and won't even say your name. That's what people will do. They'll get what they got, what you got, and get to getting and forget all about how God used you to train them, to love them, to launch them, to push them, come on and bless them. They will forget all about it, but how many know his name is Jesus? He never forgets your name. He never forgets your labor of love. He never gets that you've done in secret and you didn't tell nobody. You just blessed them. You just encouraged them. You just used the you by God to open the door for them and didn't tell nobody. Come on, give God a praise for that. He will send somebody to get you. He brought them over. And he began to tell the king what the dream meant. Hallelujah. And guess what? God began to bless him. Hallelujah. There are three things I want to say quickly, unpacking, that God uses that's working for your good. Come on, it's part of the process for your purpose. The pit, we talked about that. The minute Joseph announced he was the one, guess what? It was all in popping. Come on now. He said, you ain't going to no palace. We are not going to serve you. We're not going to obey you. We're not doing any of that. It doesn't matter. If God said you boss, then you just boss. People can get mad and fall all out. Well, why she got to be the one? Because your character ain't changed. You will tit for tat. You will compromise. That's why you not the boss. Because you'll hurt other people and be unfair in your dealing. You will deal with people according to your emotion and not deal fairly based upon what's going on. And I know the pit is a place of darkness, loneliness, separation, isolation. But that's the place, even though it hurts deeply, that God begins to transform you. Because there's nobody around. God, I feel so lonely. And know what? You're not lonely. You're alone, but you're not lonely. We just want attention. Can't y'all see him cry? I don't see these tears. Falling at the mouth. Sometimes I got more people doing that because they just want attention and cutting up like a box of razor blades. I got that from the administrator. Amen? See, this is a place where your character is made, and not on the mountaintop. In the valley. Your character ain't made on the mountaintop. Because sometimes we get back selfish. Caught up into our own flesh. Huh? But God said he'll be with you. Psalm 23:4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me. He hit you with the rod, and then the staff is, you're going to be all right though, okay? Like the old folks, kick your butt and send you to the table and get a meal. And you slobbing all in on the steak, slobbing all on your chicken. All pitiful because you want them to say, I'm sorry, nope, I kicked your butt and I meant it. Now go ahead and eat. It's not personal, it's for growth and development. And they be watching TV on the phone. Girl, yeah, I ain't playing with her. I am not playing. The devil is a liar. Coming up in here, don't be talking about it. They be in church praising God, they just kicked your butt at 8:40. Y'all seen that on the Facebook, Instagram? They just whooped you down. I love Jesus. And you sit on a pew, man, like, they so much in sin. Because they kicked your butt and you was out of line. Come on. But I knew how to shout like that. But if you kick their butt, then I do a dream. And then at the church is shouting. Hey. Just tore it myself. Just tore them up. Don't you do that to my grandkids. Tore them up on Saturday night. On Saturday night. And then you in church praising. She was fussing one time. I said, girl, you sound like your mama. Who they get up? They just fussing with each other. That's what your mama. I know I didn't do that. I know me and Keisha. I said, yes, you did. You was stirring it up. And then keep their butt Saturday night. And then just be praising God. Falling out. I know they was talking smack in their mind. I hate her. What a mean mama. Huh? I did. I said, no, she is not outside in prayer after she was doing all that. My mama. I deserved every bit of it. So just walk on through the valley of the shadow of death. God will comfort you. The rod and the staff. Number two, the prison. The prison is something that's working for your good. After he put in that pit, y'all know what I just said. And what happened to him. Amen? God will get you out of that pit after a while, refresh you, restore you, renew you, and then you get comfortable. You got your job. Come on, you've been elevated, you got some more money, got a brand new car, got a little house. I see people do it. I know I'm not just in this ministry, the ministry that I was at. And then I see their ties, and I say, you know, I want to tell on them. I want to say, even though they won't treat me right, I still want to tell the pastors, they're disrespectful, they're disrespectful, they're disrespectful, they're disrespectful. Taking out of the house and giving nothing, that will get you hurt. Amen? Because every once in a while, because the thief going to get caught robbing sooner or later. Amen? I seen them do it. I seen a girl, I know she made good money, worked a good job. And every time her tithe was $5, I said, Pastor, I told Pastor Nick, I said, when we leave here, she gonna get told on. She just up with this can on. $5 and know she making all that money, just disrespectful. And they lifting her up and patting up and everything. I bet she got told on when we left. I said, whoever gonna get the books on, tell on her. That she giving $5. I knew that wasn't all she had because her husband made extra good money too. Disrespectful. Amen. People are disrespectful in the house of God. Y'all don't know. But we are discreet. Come on, give God a praise for that. Come on. Come on. Life will tell on you. Amen. Come on, listen. What I say, life will tell on you. What I just say, life will tell on you. Amen. And I'm still preaching prophetically. Amen. The prison will isolate you, and we need that for a season because sometimes we don't see people that's around us. We don't see what's in us. We don't see what we're doing and what we're saying. Amen? But the prison, come on, it gives you a little bit more conversation. You're able to talk to people. You're able to say, you know, I'm going through something too, but I believe God. I trust Him. Give people like that. Don't give people say, girl, my toe hurt. Well, you know, my elbow hurt too. And my eye. In the back of my head. And you know what hurt? Then they say, yes, and my foot. And my arm been hurt me. Don't be with people that's going to keep on talking to the mother girl. If you get people, if you saying something, they're going to lift you up. They say, girl, you're making. You want to get through. Got to be a positive. You know, God is all in all of this, Lord, Marsha. He's in all of this. And I know it looks natural, but God is in all this. He knows how to subdue us for a season to make sure that we trust and love on Him. Do it all. Amen? That's what the prison will do. And then we head over to the palace. What a great place to be. God will take us and He wants to trust us. But when He takes us, we have to have the right character to keep us there. Amen? We have to. The process is for your good. Not designed to hurt you. But it got to kill you. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, said the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. 2 Corinthians 1:20 says, for all the promises of God in Him are yea and in Him amen, and to the glory of God by us. We have to allow the pit and the prison to be a part of our experience, elevating to the path. God's promises to you are coming to pass. I don't care. Sometimes we just act a fool. We get off track. We do things. But God said His promises are coming to pass in your life. Because God, after the pit, you don't think about it when you get to Potiphar's house. And when you get in that process, and then you're happy and get loosey-goosey, then you fall back into the prison. Guess what? You begin to remember what the pit process did for you. How it blessed you in spite of you not liking it. Come on, it was dark, it was dreary, it was wet. But in all of that, God, you was with me when I couldn't even see my hand in front of my face. You was with me, God. They couldn't destroy me. Sometimes God put you in that pit to save you and to secure you. Because if you get gone with the rest of the people that you're with, not only will you fall into a pit, you'll fall down into a rabbit hole. But God says, I'm going to put you in this pit to isolate you, to really separate you, to protect you. Because you don't know what's around you on your job. You don't know about Sarah and Bob and Paul. You don't know about them. You don't know. You don't know, come on, that it's a wolf and sheep's clothing trying to kill you. You don't know really what their heart desire and their heart is about you. You don't know that they really don't like you. They really despise who you are, but they're just around. Because just like God sent people and placed people in your life, the devil will send people and place them in your life. And guess what? It'll be to your demise if you don't discern what's in the midst of you. The Bible says, know those who labors amongst you. We don't get to know people because we get too friendly too soon. And I know y'all say, Pastor, you get friendly. Yeah, you know why? Because the friendly I am, the more I go in your belly. The friendly I am, the more I go all in your mind. The friendly that I am, see him. I gotta see for God to prove to me who you really are. I gotta see how you do with tests and trials and the pain yourself. I gotta see what you gonna do, how your character gonna be when you go through something and you don't like it. If your husband offends you, your wife offends you, your kids offend you, the ministry offends you, your job offends you, whatever's offending you, I got to see how you're going to act. I gotta see how your character is in the midst of adversity. Because if you suffer with me, you can reign with me. We let people reign too much who have not been through nothing with us. We give it out to the wrong people who have not suffered and went and died with us in anything. We just give it loose and goosey. Give God a praise in here and work it for your good. Come on, stand on your feet and give God a praise. Hallelujah, glory to God. Overall, it was used, the pit, Potiphar's house, the prison, it was used to elevate him into the palace. Because God had to bore and put pressure on him to get him in the right character. Pressure is designed to push out anything that's not like God. Anything that will disrupt your life, anything that disrupts the promises and the blessings God put you into. He had to trust him. He had to trust that he was not going to be nasty. He was not going to be bitter. Because when his brethren came in the famine, he bowed down and fed them. God didn't say give them all. He said feed them some. He gave them some. Hallelujah. You can turn them off. He gave them some just to sustain them. He didn't tell with your blessing. He did not say give it to them all. He fed his brother because they was hungry. That don't mean give him the whole kingdom. But he trusted him. And he did it without fail. Some of us will be tit for tat. Honey, they can be dry the mouth all they want to. They're not getting none of this water. They better suck on a towel. Dry. Oh, no, they not. When I was down, they wasn't. No. Sometimes God will say, just give them some. God has did that to me. I want you to go bless them. I said, God, you know what they was doing in camp? He said, I know. He said, but see, make you boss, I'm going to open up the thing. That's another thing I use. When you give the people, it'll open their spirit up and who they really are. Money. Things, a seed. Huh? Remember I told y'all about that lady, Kathy? She was exposed because I gave her seed. Come on. So many people been exposed to me because God said, do this for them. Give them this, give them that. Plant this seed. And pow, they are exposed. I said, wow, God, you tough. Money opens the door. It opens up the spirit realm. Huh? If I told you, prayer, praise, and seed, it'll get it open. Amen? It'll get it open. I remember one time this preacher, he thought he was so hidden. And one of the lady that was, I was mentoring at the time, she was cutting up in the fall to the pit because she wanted to be disobedient, rebellious. One, I'm going to go around, Pastor Carol Bumper. I'm going to go up and I'm tougher than her. I never done my mentor like that, my mom, or anybody that's an authority in my life. Amen? Because it's a price to pay. And when she tried to do that, she ended up, she put that money in his hand. Pow, his belly opened up, pow. I went in, pow, got this, this, that, boom, 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 and then closed them up, boom. And I told you about it. I said, they ain't no good. Called it out, now his ministry ain't doing nothing. Was traveling the world and all this stuff. Now ministry not doing nothing. You know why? Because I called them. And God used me to open some doors here for them. And after they got caught, I said, ain't put my name on them no more. My mouth, no way. Expose them, that money. That seed will open them up. Don't it open you up? You get to talking. Oh my God, they're so kind and so nice. And they little $100. You just like, ooh, I'm be mad. Let's get a cat. I'm like, thank you so much. And I'm still watching you. Never compromise with people for money. Y'all know what I tell them. You don't know what I tell them probably. Come see me at the church. What you can do with it. Amen. Because when people think you need them, they will begin to act inappropriately and disrespectfully. I've learned I will take it with you, because I will get on my knees and call on the Father to draw it down from heaven into earth. He's done it for me, and I've been out of work for 23 years. Come on, he met my needs and my wants. And y'all all want stuff that's expensive, amen? But he's done that because I've been a tither and a seed sower. And I did not compromise for money. I told this one lady, I said, listen, I love you with a dollar, I love you with a penny. No prophets back in the day. Oh, I just, you know, and then one day she was falling out of the box. I ate shit. Pour it in my hand, fall all down. I just held on up. Because I had warned her. I said, you trying to play games with me about your money. I said, let me tell you something. God will take everything away from you, and he'll knock the hell out of you. I preached that. Then I preached it. Then that magazine, I made a copy of it. I'm going to print it. Said, God knocked the hell out of me. He knocked the hell out of her. Knocked her out of her Porsche. Knocked her out of her BMW. Knocked her out of her Cadillac Escalade. Knocked her out of her Mercedes. Knocked her out of her 6,500 square feet home. Knocked her out of her money, and almost knocked her out of her life with a horrible stroke. She will be happy to be like you are, Marsha. No more walking. Messed up over money, being disrespectful to the woman of God. But I told her, I said, because I love you with no money, because I'm not like that. I'm not about money, but you're not going to tell me what to do with God's anointing with money. Did you hear me? She had millions to her excess. And she wanted to play that game. I'm not going to give you prophets. I'm going to knock you to church. I'm going to do it. And I said, okay, go out of here. And she almost lost her life. Her whole life has changed. Messing around. It's best just to keep your mouth off the man and woman of God. Amen? I remember my job. I went all the way in Jesus. I had one foot in Jesus, one foot in God. And they were talking about this lady on the job. And Alma was saying, baby, love God. And they were mad at women. You know, she's so tight when she goes with her gynecologist appointment. They were talking behind her back. And I was saying, hey, hold up. Hold up. Because I still love God. I was doing some stuff. Come on now. But I said, I learned, but don't put your mouth on the man and woman of God if you don't want to get hurt. I said, hold up. I was risking my job. I just moved there. I had just had a new badge. Just had Jareen. Had already had a baby. I needed a job. I said, let me tell you something. You better be quiet and keep your mouth off the woman of God. Alma loves God, and she's the woman of God. So don't get mad at her because she's celibate. She don't have to be sleeping in the street. She's a woman of God. They looked at me. Okay, Carol. Uh-huh. I got to type it. Hello. Prologue. May I help you? One moment. Geo line 34. I told them right off. And know what? They didn't say nothing. And one of them was a boss. They couldn't do nothing. See, but we're too scared to stand up for people because we won't want people to like us. I saved them from a pit. Keep your mouth off the woman of God, I told them. I was 21. And I told Alvin before I left, I said, this is what I did. I wasn't lying. She said, thank you, Miss Carol. She was in her 50s, like 48, had twins. And her husband had walked off from her. Huh? Because she loved God and he was full of foolishness. He was in God too, but then... So it's not her fault. And they want to talk about her. Find something else to talk about. She's been nice to them, kind, come to work, do her job, professional. But they want to hop over into her spiritual life and talk about her. But I would plan it right there to tell them right off. I'm not scared of people. If I'm for you, I got your back, baby. I will have my mouth there to protect you. Ain't nobody going to talk about you in my presence. They'll be like, oh, better be quiet. Be with you. Amen. Let God handle people, because he'll send somebody. Forgive them and move on into your blessing. Amen? That's what I say. Move on into your blessing. Come on, let's just worship him a little bit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is worthy. Hallelujah. Come on, just worship him a little bit. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We thank you. We praise you, Jesus. It's working for my good. The pit, yes. People not liking me, yes. People talking about me, yes. Everything works for his good. No matter what you've been through, it works for your good. My health, oh, working for my good. Come on.
Jesus, give God praise for that word. Amen. We want to thank you, Jesus, for that preached word. I ask that you would continue to have your way within our lives. We thank you for the taught word, the teach word, and the motivating word today. And I ask that you will continue to bless us as we leave this place, but not from your presence, that you will continue to cover us. In Jesus' name, we all say amen and amen. Amen. Love somebody before you leave.